everybody. Welcome to the garage. I'm Jeremy Cordeaux. I do hope you're well. I hope you're happy, and I hope you might spend some of the next, well, it should be about 20 minutes. But I sit here and I never know. It goes till it finishes. I have no idea. Anyway, I don't know, as I'm recording today's show, I don't know exactly what Pete put on the end of yesterday's program, but I'm sure it was a beautiful piece of music. Do you want to put something else on the end of today's show?
Well, I'd love to.
All right. Wait, you want to put one of yours?
Not just yet. I'll find something else. I'm just in the process of doing a new one. So.
Okay. Still lovely weather. I hope you're happy, and if it's your birthday or wedding anniversary, we'll see what it coincides with a little bit later on, who you share the day, the important day, with. But then again, every day is important. I see that New South Wales Police Commissioner has served Officer Beau Lemaire Condon with papers to show cause as to why he should not be sacked from the police force. Now, you'd be familiar with this case, I'm quite sure. It has been absolutely everywhere. He has, in effect, of course, been fired. It is not yet established exactly what he is done. I know what he's accused of. But considering this and all of the other publicity, this shocking, sordid case has thrown up, I cannot see how this guy's going to get a fair trial. Can't see it. There doesn't seem to be any presumption of innocence whatsoever on anyone's part. But the lynch mob mentality doesn't stop there, doesn't stop with him. It seems the entire police force is implicated. Not that I would worry if the Gay Mardi Gras disinvited me, if there's such a word, disinvited me, but could I remind you that the police have done nothing wrong? And you could say that this guy has done nothing wrong either, presumption of innocence, until such accusations are proved. Yet the police will not, or were not, allowed to march or celebrate or do whatever they do in Gay Mardi Gras, I don't know, if they're in uniform. Take part Saturday, but not in uniform. Apparently, the uniforms would make queer people feel uncomfortable. Now, from what I have seen, the march, year after year, and it's been going, I don't know, for 20 years or more, anything goes. Any uniform, any costume, but not a police uniform. I don't know what the world is coming to. I mean, maybe the police were, as we were talking about yesterday, guilty of transgressions in years gone by, but that was yesterday. As I said to you last week, a gay Mardi Gras is divisive. We should have Mardi Gras. Now, please get back to me, send me a comment on that, or you can call me on Friday from around the dining room table when we're broadcasting jeremycordeaux.com. You know, we just have a Mardi Gras for all. Gay, straight, black, white, girls, boys, young, old, rich, poor. Now, that's inclusive. That's inclusive. Isn't that what we should be doing? Isn't that what we are told endlessly we have to be doing? Include everyone? Huh? Hmm? Speaking of such things, I had never heard of them before. But we have a thing called the Diversity Council of Australia. I'm trying to find if I can get a spokesperson to come on the show on Friday and talk to us about the Diversity Council of Australia. Apparently they go around and they assess organisations and companies as to their diversity and inclusion. Then you get a tick or a cross, a pass or a fail, a gold star or a black mark. I don't know how it works or what the criteria is. And presumably you have to pay for the assessment. Now my question is why? Who cares? If you work for a company and you don't think it's inclusive, you're not shackled to them, joined at the hip, leave. I think. But speaking of nonsense, the classification of one of Walt Disney's most famous movies, the classic Mary Poppins, is going to be reviewed. Well, no, it has been reviewed. They're changing it from what was general exhibition. It's now going to be parental guidance required. Mary Hopkins? The movie was made back in 1964, so this is the 60th anniversary of the movie. By today's standards, this classic exposes children to discriminatory language. My God. Do you know what the problem is? You won't believe it. One of the characters, Admiral Bloom, I think it was, used to dangle from the roof of his, up there, his apartment, and he used to pretend it was a boat or something. He asks the bank's children if they're going to help him fight the Hottentots. Now, the Hottentots, I take it that he's referring to a tribe of black people in Africa, the Hottentots. Now, I can't believe these people, what are they called? The British Office of Film Classification. And yet, when you look at some of the violence and some of the crap that is allowed to pollute our screens, they pick on Mary Poppins. Oh dear. Anything, by the way, that you think I should be looking at or bringing up in the court of public opinion, please feel free to message me or to, in fact, ring us on Friday and bring it on up. Our government here in South Australia is going to spend $250,000 on influencers. Influencers. Where do you find... Pete, do you know any influencers?
No, I don't.
Where do you find an influencer?
Or a Yellow Pages. No, I don't.
They're in the book. Can you Google? I need an influencer. It's a strange world, isn't it?
Strange and getting stranger.
Yep, and the government's quite prepared to make it public that they're spending $250,000 on influencers to try and stop kids from vaping. $250,000. Whose idea was that? You want to control vaping? Do you? Make a bit of money on the side? I tell you, it's easy. Don't spend $250,000 of taxpayers' money. Fine anyone selling a vape $250,000. Did that occur to you, numbskulls? Look, I'm sorry to be simplistic, but you don't influence kids. Well, we do. We're influencing them all the time. But you tell them, you guide them, you discipline them. Yes, I did say that word. Discipline them. It doesn't cost anything. It's just called parenting. But if you are a progressive government, you couldn't possibly go down that track, could you? They are now telling us that grown-ups, adults, 50, 60-year-old people, now have or can claim that they have ADHD, attention deficit hyperactivity disorder. Wow. What was that line, Peter? Do you remember that line in I don't know what it was. Peter Sellers.
I need a little bit more to go on.
Yeah. It was about the life of Brian, I think, which was this rather sacrilegious look at Christianity, I think. And Mary, or whoever was playing Mary, I can't remember, said, you know, of Jesus, he's not the Messiah, he's just a naughty little boy. Well, when you get to be 50 or 60, you're a bit old to be a naughty little boy. The NDIS people will be rubbing their hands together and thinking to themselves, wow, we got a brand new rich seam to explore here. When is anybody going to do anything about the... I better stop it. I keep on banging on about that organization. Adelaide City Council at a recent meeting declared that it would extend the trial of electric scooters for another 12 months. God, they have been trialing these awful things for the last 5 years. Blind Freddy would see that they are a disaster, they're messy. I would love to have somebody explain what the business plan for that operation is. Heavens to Betsy, if the people who run those scooters, those electric scooters, with all the inherent dangers at every level, I take it it's an organization or a proprietary limited company, a business. I would love to know how they make money out of it. And perhaps they should be charged every time one of those things is pulled out of the river or lifted out of a tree. South Australia moves up its target for renewable electricity. Don't know if you saw that. Yes, we have. It's all going too slowly. Faster, faster. What, sir, and I guess I'm addressing the Premier when I say this, what, sir, is the problem you're trying to fix? Australia's contribution to global emissions is 1.3%. South Australia's contribution is less than 0.1%. Hardly registerable. Are you totally barking mad? You are not there to save the world, which of course you aren't doing, and at the expense of Australia and its economy. I don't think these people should ever have been elected. They're nuts. They're zealots. I don't get it. I really don't. When you think that wetlands, deltas, marshlands, landfill produce 40% of the worst greenhouse gas imaginable, and that's methane. And you never hear any of these crackpots talking about that. Amazing. I was going to say, look, these people are nuts, but, you know, I don't know. I'll tell you this little story if I've got the time. There are complaints that it's taking too long to approve wind farms. Wind farms. The Clean Energy Investment Group. Now, I take it that that's an organization that goes around seeking investment from people in clean energy, the Clean Energy Investment Group. Actually, they're not only complaining about the fact that approval for wind farms is taking too long, they think that these eyesores should be fast-tracked, just waved right on through. You know that these things take enormous amounts of aluminium and concrete to make? Aluminium and concrete produce huge amounts of greenhouse gases. And wind turbines are bloody ugly, visual pollution and dangerous to bird life. If only on environmental grounds, they should be banned. We're going to be left, a little bit like those Taipan helicopters, we're going to be left with the problem of disposing of these eyesores in future years. But these people wouldn't dream of considering atomic energy, nuclear energy. Anyway, fun and games on Friday mornings if you want to join us, jeremycordeaux.com. Tell your friends. Coming up, not this week, but next week, will be the truth about vitamins, or more, perhaps more accurately, what we need to know about vitamins. What you need to know at the moment is Jim Elder from Elder's Fine Art Gallery. Jim and Helen are looking for beautiful paintings to put up at their auction, which is coming up end of March and April. Beautiful, beautiful paintings. If you want to go and have a look at the gallery, it's an eye-opener. I've never seen a gallery quite like it anywhere in my travels. Jim Elder's Fine Art Gallery. You'll find them on Melbourne Street, North Adelaide. Jim is looking for noted Australian and international artists. And if you don't know if a painting is worth a lot of money or it's just something Aunt Jemima left you and it's up in the attic, I don't know. But it might be interesting to find out if it is worth a lot of money. It could well be. You might sort of, if you find out it's valuable, hang it in a place of prominence, or you might decide to sell it. Jim and Helen Elder's beautiful art gallery is at 106 Melbourne Street, North Adelaide. They're open Monday to Friday, 10 till 5. And all you need to do is to call Jim on 8267 2869. 8267 2869, or Jim's mobile phone is 0417 811184, and he will give you an absolutely free appraisal, at which time you can elect to sell the painting, or you can elect to just keep it and perhaps put it in your home more prominently. There was one painting recently, and it was in the December auction. I don't know, honestly, the backstory, whether the owners knew how valuable it was, but it turned out to be a Hans Heisen. And $28,488 later, the vendor was very happy. How much time have I got, Pete? Nudging it. Darren Hench, friend of mine, I've known him for years. I've known him since way back in Sydney when he was the editor of the Sun newspaper. He's announced that he's going to run for Lord Mayor of Melbourne. He's 81, he has cancer, but he says he's otherwise in very good health. Well, he'll certainly stir the place up. And speaking of Melbourne, a story on 3AW. I listen a lot to 3AW. The story says that known child sex offenders, known paedophiles, child sex offenders, are using dating apps to meet and recruit children. It seems they ask for pictures and information on the children of those people who use dating apps. So be very careful. I mean, they just could be inquiring about your children, your dependents, or it could be something a lot more sinister. Be very, very careful. Pete, have you ever used a dating app?
No.
No, I would think it would be as close to playing Russian roulette as you can get.
I think so.
William Shackle, mentioning nuclear energy earlier, Will is 17 years old. He's still at school. He is something of an absolute whiz kid. He's a genius. Will Shackle. He founded a company called Nuclear for Australia. I want to get him on either this Friday's show or next Friday's show. The ladies from Try Before You Buy were on last Friday's show, Eliza and Liberty, from Adelaide, by the way. They were on the block originally, but they're now doing their own podcast. A lot of fun. Inflation is still steady, 3.4%. Mind you, the Reserve Bank has got to get it down to that band between 2 and 3, but look, that's not a bad result. And that's, however, for a month, the quarterly figures are a better indicator. Retail figures are subdued, up 1.1%. The likes of JB Hi-Fi and Harvey Norman are not exactly over the moon about it, but they're still turning a nice profit, thank you very much. But it's taking pressure off interest rates, which is a good thing. I better leave it there. Thank you very much for viewing the Court of Public Opinion. Pete will play you a song. We'll find you something nice in a minute. This is the sort of music that largely, I don't know, Pete, how many years ago was it when I was at 5DN and you used to send me CDs yes. of songs that I could yes. play? Because they weren't popularly released, they weren't ever heard, and my audience loved them.
No, it was the 1980s, I think.
And in the 1980s, yes. See what you can find for us. March 5. Oh, look at that. The stapler was invented. How about that? And it goes back to 1868 on this day by a guy called C.H. Gould. The stapler. In 53, Joseph Stalin, dictator, General Secretary of the Soviet Union. You know how we have General Secretaries of the Trade Union Movement? Yeah. General Secretary of the Soviet Union, 1922 to 1953, dies of a stroke at 53. He was a mass murderer of incredible proportions. He made Adolf Hitler look like a Boy Scout. And yet you've still got people who admire him. Australian Labor leader Bob Hawke defeats sitting Liberal Prime Minister Malcolm Fraser in a general election in 1983. Rex Harrison, English actor, was born in 1908. The first newspaper published in Australia, the Sydney Gazette, and the New South Wales Advertiser. Published by the government printer and ex-convict George Howe. On this day in 1803. The graves of Tsar Nicholas II and his family found in St. Petersburg in 1995. Harrison Ford crash lands his 1942 Ryan Aeronautical ST-3KR in California. 2015. Patsy Cline, the American. Can you find something of Patsy Cline?
I can look.
Yeah. Have a look. Patsy Cline, American singer. Crazy, I Fall to Pieces, Walking After Midnight. I think the best thing she ever did was All Alone Am I. All Alone Am I, ever since your goodbye. All alone with just the beat of my heart. It's a great song, that. I heard... she died very young, plane crash at the age of 30. Sam Colt manufactures his first pistol. It was a 34 caliber Texas model in 1936. Are you familiar with that?
It might be the Patterson Colt, I think.
Oh. The Spitfire makes its first flight at Eastleigh Aerodrome in Southampton on this day in 1936. Wow. The largest milkshake ever made. Why would you want to make a big milkshake, I wonder? 1,955 gallons of chocolate. It was made in South Africa on this day in 1994. Why? 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 Bugatti announces the most expensive new car ever made. It was the La Voltaire Noire, costing $16.7 million, that's almost $19 million, Only one was ever made. 2019 was the year. Smoking tobacco was introduced into Europe by the Spanish physician. He was a doctor. How the wheel turns. Not to speak of even the worm. A Spanish physician, Francisco Fernandez, 1927, 1,000 US Marines land in China to protect American property. I wouldn't advise you do that today. That was in 1927 on this day. And one more. 1946, Winston Churchill makes his very famous Iron Curtain speech in Fulton, Missouri. Yeah. Popularizes the term, and he draws attention to the divisions which were occurring in Europe. The Iron Curtain has fallen. Thank you so much for viewing the Court of Public Opinion. We will be back tomorrow. I'm Jeremy Cordeaux, Peter Clayton and I. Believe in yourself, and goodbye for now.
This person's been a dear friend of mine for a long time.
That's right.
And a friend of my husband's before me, so she's also my friend-in-law.
That's right.
It's all yours, Emmy.
All right. Well, I'm pleased to be here tonight as a songwriter, because I probably went through the world's longest writing block of about 6 years between writing songs. And so I guess now that I've appeared publicly on this show, I'm going to have to keep on writing. So I'm going to do one that you will not have heard. This is my newest composition. In a lonely room, waiting for the night to fall, I hear your voice. And every whippoorwill that calls, and it takes me back to a better place and a sweeter time.